Thank you. action. Karen is back after her little surgery. Thank you. Looking good. Yes, Dan.
Prayers for the Mills family. For Alvin, yeah, Alvin Mills passed away a couple days ago. A lot of people don't know the other. They were old now, 20 people.
I have a neighbor. It's Linda Sullivan's brother, Daryl Streetman, who is on hospice. He's not doing well at all. I talked with his wife last week, and she said it's just a matter of time. And she's the one staying home and taking care of him. And they need their prayers.
Y'all hear their names again?
Streetman.
Streetman, but first name's
Daryl.
Daryl and Diane.
Daryl and Diane. Yes, Helen.
My friend Kathy Brown, she's probably going to have colon surgery. I don't know anything yet.
Okay, Kathy Brown. We have two good friends here from, I do have two good friends. Only two.
Didn't have to fail.
And one of them I'm not sure about, but his sense of humor tells me we're all right. Bill and Ann Strutback from, well, they're really from Sugar Land, but we knew each other through church and choir and mission work. Bill is very active in Habitat for Humanity, and construction and all, and also the ladder in my garage. Think of him every time I open that. It's open so easily, so nice of him. Good job, Bill. Bill and Ann, such good friends. Thank you for being here and worshiping with us. You just raised our attendance by 12%. We've had full church, though, the last several services, so it's been a good year together. This is our fifth Sunday of the month. We're not having Fifth Sunday fellowship dinner, you know that, right? So it's a tradition. On the fifth Sunday, we always have a potluck. And it's a great time of coming together. And I'm buying. we'll see. Feeding the 5,000. Thank you all for being here. Yes.
I also have a joy. My good friends Donna and Dennis Charlton are visiting this morning with their handsome little grandsons.
Yes, I met the son, grandsons. Welcome. Good to have you all here. And to our live streaming audience, good morning. Welcome. Happy New Year to come. Thank you for being with us. Let us know how we can be of service to you as well. Keep us in touch with your needs. Your prayers are always welcome. And we thank you for worshiping with us. Let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Please stand, sing Prepare Ye the Way.
My God, with riches are here to find us our bed.
you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Let's stand now and sing hymn number 219, My Child's Day.
God, we don't know where the time has gone. We awake one day and it's Thanksgiving, and another day it's Christmas, and today, 2 days only remain of this old year. We don't know what to make of the coming of the new year. It's a time, Lord, of so much hurt in our world, so much hunger, so much division, so much confusion, and yet through it all, there you remain, the one constant in our lives whose faithfulness and kindness to us seems unaffected by all that troubles us. In your word, you remind us of your great light in our darkness. When we walk a road that is dark, we long to see beyond that dark into the stars of night, those glimpses of your light, your presence. In our prayers, Lord, we look for the words, we look for the description of what we are experiencing and how we believe you are also a part of it. And we come to know you as the best listener we have in all our lives. Even in your hour of sorrow, to see such divisiveness amongst us, you are listening to us. You speak to us through the gentle singing of the lark. When times are hard, your never turns to stone. May you always remember that when shadows fall, we know we do not walk alone. And so it is that we can sing such a hymn as Coming Together with Joy, because it is with that joy that we meet you, and your presence always near is such friendship such hope for better things to come, better days ahead, better futures for all, and our hearts turn to praise. And Lord, we give thanks and praise to you, Almighty God. There is a togetherness that emerges in our midst that is the work of your Holy Spirit, and we feel encouraged, strengthened, even emboldened to confront the divisions and to be peace speakers on your behalf and ours. Hear the prayers of our hearts in thankfulness for the year past, in hopeful expectation of the year to come, and whatever it may hold for us as keepers of your promises. This we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now, as the ushers come forward, let us give thanks for the giving of our time, our service, and of our gifts. Lord, we commit our lives, our service, our time to your work. We give you thanks for including us and those in need in the midst of your loving care. Amen.
News. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son.
Thank you. children who would like to come forward. Or more. Children besides Kelly. Come on up, guys. Come on up. Boy, am I glad you guys are here. Come on up and have a seat. Now, you told me your name was George. No, what? Raven. Vaden. How do you spell it? V-A-Y-D-E-N. Oh, Vaden. And Trey. Trey. They're guests. Have you ever had a message of good news? Have you had one, Trey? Sometime? What was your message of good news? You went where? You went to Disneyland on Thanksgiving? Mickey and Minnie there? How about Goofy? Yeah, Goofy's my favorite. I can understand Goofy. Where do you suppose good messages come from? God said to Mary, you're going to have a son, we're going to call his name Jesus. Now, how did he get the message to Mary? An angel named Gabriel. Thank you. How did you know that? Church. Good place in the day. And so whenever God has a message he wants to send to his people, angels are right there ready to take the message. I have a little granddaughter. We call her an angel. Is she an angel, really? Really? She can be? I'll trade. If she does what? If what? If she reads messages. Yes. And her little brother loves to snuggle and hug with grandma. Does that count as a message? Can be. It sure is. Grandma thinks it's a message, and I think grandma's right. It's a message of love. Exactly right. So while God has his angels, is it possible that we could be an angel and spread good news and give good messages to people we know and we love? Yeah, we could be, couldn't we? We always end our time together with a prayer. Will you pray with me? Can you pray with me? Dear Lord, we thank you for your angels who bring us messages of love. May we sometime be one of your angels to share your good news. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Vaden and Trey, you made our day. Oh, I just made that up. Yes. Now, you ring the bell here at the church. You want to ring the bell for us? I'll just roll. And we're going to ring it three times. Why? What's three times?
One to the Father, one to the Son, one for the Holy Ghost.
Four. Make it ring.
Make it ring.
last verse was our morning anthem. Right?
Yeah.
We'll go with that. Our scripture readings begin in the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. In the 9th chapter, we read, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation, thou hast increased its joy. They rejoice before thee as with joy at the harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor thou hast broken as on the days of Midian. For every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this." And then the change in the New Testament, it should be Matthew chapter 2. Following verses. "Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there till I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him. And Joseph rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, Out of Egypt have I called my son. Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, was in a furious rage, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem, in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time which he had ascertained from the wise men. And then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation. Rachel weeping for her children, she refused to be consoled because they were no more. When Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared again in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, Rise, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are now dead. And he rose and took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus reigned over Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that what was spoken by the prophets might be fulfilled. His name shall be called a Nazarene." The reading across the word to us may be a blessing for our daily lives.
Thanks be to God.
You know, in the Old Testament, Jesus, the Messiah, is described as the Lion of Judah. And in the New Testament, he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Not only is Jesus both the Lion and the Lamb, he makes them to stand side by side. Do you think that's possible? We've heard a litany of oxymorons over time. They're kind of fun if we don't understand them, but it's one of those unique combinations of terms that both make sense and make no sense whatsoever. And we all smile and nod because we understand and we're marveling at our ability to understand. Phrases like jumbo shrimp, long shorts, fresh frozen, pretty ugly, holy war, and yes, even inactive Christian. Have you ever considered that just maybe we've celebrated one of the most memorable oxymorons of all time when we sang that carol entitled Silent Night? When's the last time we had a silent night? Anyone here a Christmas Eve shopper? I wasn't asking for a sample, but thank you for that. There are some people who either shop then because they want to take advantage of last-minute bargains that come, or they just like to be up in the midst of a madhouse atmosphere, feeling some activity swirling around them. They must wonder at the absence of silence in their nights. Of course, some of us would admit it's just plain old procrastination, really, that forces us to fight our ways through hordes of other desperate shoppers on Christmas Eve, or even after. Cash registers ringing, bags and boxes crunching and crashing, harried shoppers bustling and bumping, parking lots filled with screeches and honking. These are real sounds of our not-so-silent nights. They're not only the loud sounds cascading around us, they also reflect the feelings churning within us. Do you think they'll get better when we go home? What would you guess is the decibel level of an average Christian home at the time of Christmas? Sounds of kids coming home for the holidays, fighting over favorite TV programs, complaining of who got what toy, arguing over scissors and paper and tape, the sound of the holiday chef in the kitchen trying to do as much as possible for that massive meal coming up next, dishes clattering, pans rattling, cupboard doors slamming, sound of official toy assemblers, muffled perhaps by the walls of the basement of the garage or attic workspace they're crammed into, while they assemble one last toy. But perhaps this year's most annoying noise is that coming from elected politicians. The arena of discussion and debate has deteriorated into chaotic conspiracy theories and calling names that are an embarrassment to thoughtful and civil dialogue. Listen to the assessment of Sam Keen, author of the book entitled Hymns to an Unknown God, which he published back in 1995. He wrote, "Creating a political community based on kindness may seem like an impossibility, but we are discovering lately in American society that we cannot build a good society on the principles of self-interest and entitlement alone. Without generosity," he wrote, "there can be no community. Without the kindness of strangers, the society is turned into an armed camp. The atmosphere of compassion that transforms a mass of alienated individuals into a caring community is created by countless acts of kindness and charitable foresight." I would suggest there's another approach to civil discourse at a time when it is so badly needed. an approach that's both mutually supporting and productive of goodwill. Instead of asking one's opinion, ask them questions of their story. I rather enjoy asking people about their stories. Where's home country for you? What was it that brought you to Texas? What was it that brought us to Oklahoma? I was a Nebraska fan. What's been the best thing that happened to you recently? To offer hospitality through conversation to a stranger is to welcome something new, something unfamiliar, something unknown into our life's world. Strangers have stories to tell which we've never heard before. Stories which can redirect our seeing and stimulate our imaginations. Their stories invite us to view the world from a novel perspective. What was the longest trip you've taken? Have you traveled abroad? Where would you go if you could? You know that my heart's appeal to the mission in Liberia is special to me, but after we concluded the mission trip to Liberia at 6:30 in the morning, we're at the airport, waiting for our flight to be called, and there was another man who looked like what I was feeling. Not quite fully awake, hoping for some cup of coffee sometime, somewhere. And I approached him and I asked him what it was that he did here in Liberia. He said, I'm a citizen of Liberia, but I've grown more recently become a citizen of the United States. I work with missions. I said, really? That's why we're here. And I began to tell him a bit of our missions. I didn't tell him that one of our great hopes was to raise enough funding for a bus so that we could bring our 70-some students into the school. But I didn't need to tell him that. When I asked him what he did, he said, I sell buses. I said, what? He said, I sell buses. And he leaned over and pulled out his briefcase of a catalog of buses that have been recycled around the world. And he buys them and ships them to Liberia. And he employs people to upgrade and fix and to restore buses. Could you do one for our school? Gave me a copy of the catalog, and that was the beginning of the first of three buses we acquired from My Heart's Field. Simple conversation, a really strong bridge. Or the time in an elevator running in Singapore, and on my Oklahoma City Chiefs shirt, the man and his wife got on the elevator, and he looked at me and he said, I've never been to Oklahoma. And I said, I'm sorry. Where's home for you? He said, we're from Pennsylvania. I said, really? My sister lives in Pennsylvania in the eastern part, near Lancaster. He said, I know that area. He said, you know Akron? Yes, I know Akron. I thought, this is great. We're making a connection. Then I said, but you've never been west to Oklahoma or South Dakota, where I grew up. He said, nope, never been east or west of Pennsylvania. And his wife said, well, our daughter married a young man from South Dakota. I said, really? Where in South Dakota? Oh, it's a town down on the river. There's a bridge that goes from that town into Nebraska. I said, Yankton. He said, yeah, you know it. Born and raised there. What's the name of the man your daughter married? And they said, Roger Hyricks. And I said, Roger Hyricks and I grew up together. We're the same age. He pitched like caught all through Little League. I know Roger really well. The doors of the elevator opened. They went one way, and I went another. But another bridge had been built, another memory. It's easier to make a habit of hospitality when we remember how much Jesus is present in the practice. This according to Christine Cole and Pamela Buck, who wrote a little study guide, Recovering Hospitality as a Continuing Christian Tradition. They wrote, We can see Jesus in strangers and guests, and we can act as Jesus when we play the role of host. It said Esther DeWall suggests that at the end of all our hospitable activity, we are faced with two questions. Did we see Christ in them? Did they see Christ in us? Our conversations reveal more of ourselves and what we value than does any argument. Bringing our story to the fore, sharing our experiences, our story, is not only a way of building bridges, it is a way of revealing Christ in our lives. Rear Admiral Jeremiah Denton was a captive during the Vietnam War and imprisoned in Hanoi. And he reflected on his experience as a prisoner of war. He wrote, I had a small cross that meant a lot to me. It had been made by a fellow POW out of bamboo strands. Making it had been a great risk for him. Getting it to me was a great risk for both of us. And I knew, he writes, the guards would never let me keep that cross. So I hid it in a propaganda pamphlet along with a list of other prisoners in the camp. By day, the pamphlet was under my pallet, but at night I took it out, and I held the cross in my hand as I prayed. There was a great spiritual comfort in it for me. I had the cross several months when I was told that a North Vietnamese work crew was making his way through the camp, cutting down the ventilation openings with brick. When my turn came, I was ordered outside while the guard made a search of my cell. After a few moments, I heard his grunt of triumph. He had found the cross. Coming out, he stood glaring at me, as then he broke the cross into bits and threw the pieces into an open sewer. I was furious and helpless. The worker had been standing by watching five or six very old Vietnamese men and women, too old for any other kind of work. They were ordered into my cell to do their job. Half an hour passed before they came out and I was allowed to return. Immediately, he said, I reached under the pallet and I found the pamphlet. The list of prisoners was gone. Still angry, I began tearing the pamphlet apart, and then I felt the bulge in its pages. There was a cross, a new one. Carefully and beautifully woven from the straw strands of a broom. Obviously, the work crew had made it, and I shuddered at the thought of the punishment they would have suffered had they been caught. And then he said, I realized something even more important, something that gave me even more spiritual comfort and hope for the future as I prayed with a new cross. Despite the deeds of human beings that I can make enemies out of strangers, the love of God can still reach down and make us better brothers and sisters. Whatever we do or say in our conversations with each other and with those whom we meet, the real questions that we must ask are these. Do we see Christ in them? Will they see Christ in us? A countenance of peace introduces an affirmation of another person. Making Jesus the focus of our conversation will bring out our Christian values. Acknowledging that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God opens the door to matters of the soul, wherein lie our acceptance and forgiveness for one another. Seeking Christ in each other, revealing Christ to each other, redeems our relationships from reliance on self-righteousness and transforms us in his image. Jesus, as the Lion of to confront its self-serving power. As the Lamb, he removes our sin and opens the way to honesty and integrity in our relationships. The way before us is open. Sharing our story encourages others to share theirs. Together we can restore the bridges between us and live our lives in ways worthy of the sacrifice that he made for us. I gave a public lecture a few years ago in China. In the midst of my speech, I referred to a phrase common to you all, something about separating the chaff from the wheat. Following my address, there was a group of about a dozen students who came up to me, and one young man said, excuse me, sir, we believe you are a Christian. I said, I am. How do you know that? He said, you referred to the wheat and the chaff found in all four Gospels. It's a Christian story. And I said, it is. He said, we'd like to speak with you. I said, all right. I said, sure, of course. Later, a former student of mine took a picture of the group. There was nearly 70 students in that picture who came just to hear something of my story and answers to some of their questions. Things in China were changing. Government property was being returned to churches. Churches were opened again. Fewer than a million people were Christians in the 1980s. By the mid to late 90s, that number had grown to 16 million in China. It's a small start in a country of 1.4 billion people, but it's a powerful start because we are willing to share our stories with each other. There is hope. Thanks be to God. Speaking of angels, let's stand and sing a closing hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. twice a week. Bill goes on Tuesday and I go on Thursday. Is that you? Other birthdays, anniversaries? Yes, it was. Or no, yes, it is. It's coming.
Tomorrow
or the 31st?
31st.
Day after tomorrow.
I barely got here.
Just in time for a tax deduction. Still good plan.
She's sliding.
Well, Lucille, why don't you stand and Bill and Ann as our guests just stand. We've got this.
Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Frank has that relieved look on his face. He knew it was
sometime.
Yes. Church office will be closed the 31st because of New Year's Eve and also on the 1st.
About 3 a.m. tomorrow.
Monday morning Methodist will not meet tomorrow. Gayla and I will be arranging a visitation of communion. If you know someone who would appreciate receiving a communion, call the church office. We probably have their name on our list, but just to be sure, we're not missing anybody. We're not aware of somebody who would really appreciate it. We'd like to know it. Nothing else, let's gather up and